You don't want to underpower your speakers. Underpowering is a good way to blow drivers. Have you heard that one? Yeah, I've heard that one. Let's have a little talk about loudspeaker power ratings and matching your speakers with the right-sized amplifier. My name is Barry. I'm a sound engineer in the Minnesota area, and I do these sound advice videos on technical topics regarding sound reinforcement and pro audio. This topic relates to both pro audio and home audio or car audio. It's about loudspeaker power handling. If you enjoy this sort of thing, I would encourage you to reach down and click that subscribe button so that you can follow the channel, and that really helps a lot. I'd also encourage you to hit the bell icon so that you're notified when new content drops. Let's break down some of these myths. Now, for example, let's say that I have, as I do, a pair of sound reinforcement loudspeakers that are rated for 800 watts. On the back of the speaker, it says 800 watts maximum, as it does in the sales literature. And these are some fairly heavy-duty, high-quality loudspeakers. If I was to ask folks what size amplifier I should use with those speakers, I would expect to get probably three different answers. The first answer I'd expect would be an amplifier of 400 to 600 watts would probably be about right sized. That would get you up to within a couple of dB of the maximum output of that box and still give you some margin of safety so that you can probably be safe from blowing anything up. And there's really no reason to push a loudspeaker to its very maximum limits, because once you get within a dB or so of its maximum output, you start entering into power compression, where you can put more power into the box, but you're not going to get much more output. It's somewhat like in an automobile where you can press down the accelerator pedal and go faster and faster and faster, but at some point the car will reach its maximum speed and you may be able to continue pressing the accelerator pedal another half an inch, but the car just won't go any faster, and at that point you're just wasting fuel. The other answer I would expect to get is, well, the box is rated for 800 watts, so an amplifier around 800 watts would be a pretty good fit. And then the final answer would be, you don't want to underpower your speakers. If you underpower your speakers, you're running risk of blowing drivers. There's a rule of thumb in the industry saying that you should put an amplifier on your box that's rated somewhere in the ballpark of 1.5 times the power rating of the box. So if that's a 800-watt box, maybe 1,200 watts, a 1,500-watt amplifier would be a good fit for that application. Now, my initial response to that is that we know what blows up speakers. Either putting a boot through the cone or putting too much power into the driver. And when you put too much power into the driver, it causes the mechanicals of the driver to move beyond their mechanical limits, and that can damage the suspension, and then the cone or the diaphragm doesn't move smoothly and accurately anymore, or it jams up. You could also apply too much power to the speaker over a longer period of time, which would cause the voice coil to overheat and possibly melt the glue and distort the voice coil former, which causes the voice coil not to fit properly anymore into the magnet assembly, and that can start dragging or causing problems. You could also put so much power into the driver that the wires in the voice coil overheat and melt, and then the connection is broken, and when the current can't pass through the wires because the wires burned up, well, the speaker gets pretty quiet. Underpowering won't do any of those things. But there is a grain of truth in that don't underpower your speaker statement. We'll get into that in just a moment. Now, having said all of these criteria about these 800-watt speakers, we then have to ask, do we believe the manufacturer's spec? because those speakers are rated at 800 watts. And at some point later in their production, they came out with a new version. And the new version is now rated at 2,000 watts. And I don't see any difference between the old version and the new version. From as far as I can tell, they're using the same drivers, the same crossover, I think even the same enclosure. The only difference that I can see between the old model and the new model is the silk screen on the back that says 800 watts or 2,000 watts, and the spec sheet. So how does this happen? Well, my suspicion is that there is a meeting between the sales team and the engineering team. And it probably went something along the lines of the sales team was asking the engineers, saying, hey, our competitor's product in this market segment is rated for 1,500 watts, but our box is only rated for 800. What gives? And the engineering team would say, well, we're familiar with the competitor's product, and our product is just as rugged as theirs. And I'm not sure how they're really claiming 1,500 watts. That seems a little optimistic. That must be some peak power specification. To which the sales team would say, oh, well, if that's peak power, what can our box handle for peak power? Engineering replies with, well, probably about 1,500 watts. Now, we've got some pretty good protection circuitry in the box that should protect things if it gets a little too severe. You might be able to put in a really brief pulse of close to 2,000 watts and things should hold up, but I wouldn't recommend it. At which point, sales said, oh, 2,000 watts. Sounds great. Let's update the spec sheet. So we have three different ways of looking at power ratings of the box. The first way would be RMS, root mean square. This is continuous average long-term power. And this will be the lowest number. Let's say for this box, it's probably 200 or 300 watts. So you could put 200 or 300 watts continuously, full-time, into that driver, and it should endure. And that kind of spec is probably most useful when dealing with a speaker that's going to be reproducing material that is extremely dense. For example, a loudspeaker that's inside of an instrument amplifier that's reproducing, for example, electric guitar. The next spec, which is probably the most common way these things are marketed, is through program power. And when we say program, we're talking about speech or average music. What is average music? Well, it's average. Hip-hop music with extreme deep bass or harpsichord music with extreme high frequencies, I would say, is a little outside of average. But assuming average, typical, uncompressed music, those kind of program sources have fairly significant peaks and a fairly low average power level. Typically, the average power level is between 1/8 to 1/3 the power level of the peaks. And so you could have peaks that are hitting 800 watts with the average power maybe 100 to 200 watts, somewhere in that range, when playing typical uncompressed music. And we would call that program material. And in this case, the box is rated for 800 watts of program material. So the peaks in that program are touching around 800 watts. And the average is a couple hundred. And the box should tolerate that level. And of course, the final spec would be peak power, which would be how much power the box can endure on a very short period of time, like a transient peak. And of course, the box may have some protection circuitry in it to help it endure these transients. So, there's a number of factors that control how much power the box can handle. What the spectral density is, and what the peak to average ratio in power is. And when talking about the spectrum, that's another thing that we have to consider. If you open up the box and take a look inside, you'll see that the low-frequency driver, the woofer, is a pretty significant piece of hardware. In the box that I'm talking about, it's got a big cast iron frame, probably 20 to 25 pounds of magnet, big 3 or 4 inch voice coil on it. You can look at that driver and say, that's a pretty significant piece of hardware. And it would make sense that something that's that beefy can probably handle a few hundred watts of power on a long-term basis, or maybe 800 watts of power program going in. But if we look at the other drivers in the box, the mid-range drivers and the high-frequency drivers, well, because of the shorter wavelengths involved, those drivers are going to be smaller than the woofer. And they're also going to be less able to handle power. So, for example, that woofer might take 800 watts of program, but the high-frequency drivers may only be rated for 100 watts, maybe even less. And that's fine, because that is the typical spectrum of the program material the box is designed to reproduce. Music has a lot of power in the bass and not a lot of power in the treble. And that's just the nature of things. And so knowing that, that gives us a little bit of insight into this underpowering can damage your speakers statement. You see, underpowering itself isn't going to damage anything. That's like driving your car, which can do 130 miles an hour flat out, at 50 miles an hour. It's no problem. Might even be good for its longevity. But the problem with underpowering your speakers isn't that you're underpowering the speakers, it's that you may be inclined to try to drive the system to power levels that your amplifier is unable to deliver. Typically, music is a collection of sine waves, where the voltage coming out of the amplifier that drives the speaker smoothly goes up, hits a peak, and then comes down to the bottom side and goes back up. And that causes the cones of the loudspeakers to move in and out nice and smoothly. Now, if you try to make your amplifier do more than it's really capable of doing, it will rise the voltage up, and then it will hit the maximum limit of the amplifier. And it can't keep going up anymore. It'll just flat top right at that point at the maximum voltage that it can deliver. And then the signal will go down, and the same thing will happen on the bottom end, where the bottom end will be clipped off rather than a nice rounded curve. And we know the sound of a distorted amplifier, which is kind of harsh and raspy. And so the difference is that when the signal is undistorted, a pure note would have energy in one spot where that note is, where the fundamental frequency is. But if the amplifier is pushed too hard into distortion, that note will get clipped off in the top and bottom and become distorted, and that will impart a bunch of additional high-frequency energy into the signal. And it will become more like a square wave rather than a sine wave in the output. And the difference between a sine wave and a square wave is that a sine wave has all of its energy concentrated at one frequency, the fundamental frequency, whereas a square wave has the fundamental frequency plus a whole bunch of odd-order harmonics above that. And all those harmonics are a great deal of high-frequency energy. So if you drive the system to the point where you're clipping your amplifier and creating distortion, you could be creating a signal that goes into your speakers that has a whole lot more high-frequency content in it than typical music. And all of that high-frequency content could overpower the high-frequency drivers, which are designed to reproduce music, not distortion and high-energy tones. And so that's where that statement that you don't want to underpower your speakers comes from, because you want to have an amplifier that's big enough so that you don't clip the amplifier, even in the loudest passages. Now, there's a lot of amplifiers that provide a feature for clip limiting, so as soon as you get near the top power of the amplifier, it limits the input signal so you can't easily overdrive the amplifier into a clipping state. You could also put your own limiter in front of the amplifier to do the same kind of function, to prevent you from overdriving the amplifier. Of course, amplifiers with DSP would have this sort of ability as well. And so what can we do to prevent loudspeaker damage? Well, like I said, you can do limiting on the front end to make sure you don't overdrive your amplifiers. That's important. The other thing we can do is to limit the amount of low frequency energy that goes into the speaker that is below the operating range of the speaker. The loudspeaker, driver, and the box, they work as a team together in a tuned system. And so the box supports the driver and allows the driver to operate more effectively at low frequencies. But there's a limit to it. In order to provide low frequency control, the box has to be fairly large just because of the wavelength of sound and the physics involved. And so if you want a box that can operate into the deep subsonic region, typically that has to be a pretty large enclosure. So most woofer systems have some limit to the bottom end that's probably somewhere in the 40, 50 hertz range. Now, if you try to go much below that, the box itself will not have the same level of damping control on the driver. And so the driver may be able to handle quite a bit of power in its operating range, up at 100 hertz or so. But once you get down to 25 hertz, the driver begins to act as if it's just sitting in free air and it's unloaded. And there isn't the acoustical damping being provided by the box that helps suppress excessive cone motion. And so you might be able to put a fair amount of power into that driver at 100 hertz, but if you put that same amount of power into the driver down at 25 hertz, you may find that the driver will exceed its mechanical limits and become damaged. And then what exacerbates this are folks who try to push systems to produce super deep low bass that they're really not capable of doing. So you might have some synth music or hip-hop music that has some really super deep bass components. And if you try to shake the house with that by pushing up that EQ fader down at 20 hertz or 30 hertz, you could try to drive too much low-frequency spectrum into that box that it just can't handle. And remember that modest changes in EQ can equate to pretty significant differences in power. If you nudge the EQ fader up by 6 dB, well, now that's increased the power at that range by about 4 times. If you push the fader up for a 10 dB boost, that increases the power in that portion of the spectrum by 10 times. So it's certainly possible to break things by trying to apply quite a bit of EQ boost. People don't realize sometimes the power impact of those boosts. And you need to be careful with your system at frequencies that are below FB, which is the frequency of the box tuning. So the system has a lower power handling capability at extreme low frequencies. And then at the frequencies above where the woofer driver is, as you get into the mid-ranges and the high-frequency drivers. And we also have the issue of distortion from the amplifier can be very damaging, especially to the high-frequency drivers. One of the ways that you could mitigate that is to bi-amplify the system, where you have a separate amplifier and an external crossover that operates each of the different sections of the box. So you have an amplifier that is driving the woofers, and then a separate amplifier which is driving the high frequency sides of the box. And so in that case, if you push things a little too hard and you accidentally clip the woofer amplifier, well, it'll put out distortion into the woofers, and that might not be ideal, but that distortion will not carry over into the mids or the high frequency side of the box and possibly cause damage to those drivers. As I mentioned earlier, boxes have a characteristic called power compression, which is at some certain power level, they just won't produce a whole lot more output. You can push more power into it, but you're just not going to get a lot more output. And so that's what I listen for. If the system is starting to sound a little bit mushy, or As you push the faders up more and more, it's just not quite as responsive as at lower levels. That's an indication to me that I'm probably reaching the capabilities of that box. And so I try to stay within the manufacturer's specifications power-wise, more or less. I try to keep in mind the spectrum of the material that I'm putting into the box to make sure it's reasonable and doesn't have a particularly strong skewing towards either the extreme high ends or low ends. And just try to be careful not to break things. So I hope that was interesting and helpful for you, and gives you a little bit of insight as to how I consider what power amplifiers to apply to what boxes. I take it with kind of somewhat of a grain of salt. I don't think that, you know, a 500 watt box needs exactly a 500 watt amplifier or a 1200 watt amplifier. I tend to lean a little bit on the large side just so I always have some headroom. And knowing that, I tend to be careful on the controls, not to push things too hard and try to break stuff. So I hope that that helps, and I hope that your speakers work great for you and that you have fantastic shows, and that you will choose to check out future videos here on Sound Advice. And I appreciate you tuning in and hope to see you on the next one.